So hi everyone, myself Vinita Tiwari and I welcome you all to my YouTube channel Learn Life Science. So today I'm going to start with genetic engineering topics. So this is going to be the first part in which I will be discussing about cloning vectors. Okay, so in case of cloning vectors, first I will explain you what are vectors, what are their characteristics which makes them a vector. Okay, and then we will see what are plasmids and its type. Particularly in this video, the most of the portion will be covered for plasmid and its types, and also we will discuss about PBR322 and its features. Okay, so PBR322 is also a plasmid and it is most commonly used plasmid in genetic engineering protocols. Okay, so without any delay, we are going to start. So first I will give you a little overview about what is genetic engineering. Okay, in genetic engineering, we generally create new combination of heritable material. Okay, we are generally concerned with formation of new combination of genetic material. Okay, for example, we know, for example, you are targeting any kind of protein, for example, protein X. There is a protein which is termed as X. Okay, you can take any protein. We know that this protein is formed by the translation process, right? The mRNA is translated to form this protein. Okay, there is coding process, and we also know that this mRNA is encoded by the double-stranded DNA, right? So this double-stranded DNA comprises a segment of region which is termed as a gene. Okay, these gene, particularly gene X, is responsible for the formation of protein X, right? You can see here there is transcription which forms the mRNA, and then there is translation which gives us the desired protein. For example, if you want to create the production, or if you want to design a protocol for the production of the protein by a fermentation method, for example, if you want to use bacteria, you can use the bacteria for the production of this protein. Okay, so for example, if I want to make this protein in stock in laboratory, okay, in laboratory by the method of fermentation, so first it is important that we are having this double stranded DNA that is going to transcribe and translate in the bacteria. Right, so for this purpose we require a vector. Okay, for example, I am taking this double stranded vector. Okay, we will also discuss the characteristics of vector, but just for now we will see that this is a vector, and this is our desired gene which we want to express in the bacterial cell. Okay, you will understand it soon. So the first thing is isolation of the target gene. Okay, so the first thing is there is necessity to isolate that target gene. For example, I'm writing here gene X. Okay, isolation of target gene. After that, you will have to use this vector. The vector should be opened up by using a particular enzyme which is termed as restriction endonuclease. Restriction endonuclease is an enzyme which is involved in cleavage of the vector at a particular target site. Okay, restriction endonuclease will do its action and the vector will simply open up in this form. Okay, for example, the restriction sites are present here and here. Okay, so restriction endonuclease open up the vector, and now you can simply insert this gene in here. Okay, by the process of ligation. Okay, ligase is an enzyme which is involved in this process. So what you can see here, that we have joined the foreign DNA, the DNA from a different source to another DNA which is also from different source. Okay, so you can see here it is a new combination of genetic material which is known as recombinant DNA. It is composed of two different DNA which are from two different sources. Okay, so this is recombinant DNA. So what we are going to do with this DNA. We are simply going to insert this DNA in the host cell. In the host cell. For example, this is our host cell. The most commonly used host cell is E. coli. Okay. So you will insert the DNA right here. Okay, apart from that, the genomic DNA of the E. coli is also present in the cell. Okay, we are not concerned with this. We are concerned with this recombinant DNA. So what is going to happen? This E. coli will now multiply. Right, it will multiply and the cells will also further multiply and produce multiple mass of cells. Okay, there will be generation of multiple cells. We also know that the cell divides, and along with the cell division, there is also replication of genetic material. So therefore, now our recombinant DNA is also going to get incorporated in each cell by the process of segregation. Okay, now our target gene is multiplied enough, and now in the culture system, this bacteria, for example, if I take this particular bacteria, okay, this is the bacteria, this is our recombinant DNA. We know that this is going to form the mRNA and it is going to produce the protein, and this protein is nothing but our protein X. Okay, so there will be mass production of this protein in the culture system. So what you are basically doing, you are simply isolating the target gene which is concerned with the expression of that particular protein. Okay, you are isolating the target gene, you are incorporating it in a vector. The vector has multiple characteristics because of which we are going to use it for this recombination method. Okay, so I hope this picture is clear in your mind. Now we are shifting towards the vector, means what are vectors and what are their characteristics. Okay, this is a general overview. Okay, so cloning vectors, you can also use the term cloning vector, or you can use carrier DNA, vehicle DNA, or you can also use the term vehicle for cloning. Okay, now what is the definition? The definition is the DNA molecule which can carry foreign DNA fragment when inserted in it are called as cloning vectors. So we have studied about the cloning vector. So in this case, it is, the vector is also a DNA fragment, double-stranded DNA. This DNA fragment should be capable of carrying a foreign DNA. Okay. For example, if you insert the foreign gene, it should be capable of handling this DNA. Okay. It should be capable of handling this foreign DNA. Apart from that, there are multiple features. For example, this vector should have its own ORI region. ORI is the region from where the replication starts. Okay, the region on DNA from where replication starts. Right, apart from that, there are certain kinds of selectable markers which we are going to study. Then there are certain kinds of antibiotic resistance. Okay, these are selectable markers. Then there are certain kinds of restriction sites. And these restriction sites are for the restriction endonuclease, which are highly specific. Okay, so now we will be studying about the characteristic. So the first characteristics is the vector must be able to replicate in the host cell. For example, if we have taken E. coli as the host cell, this is its genomic DNA and this is our vector. The vector should be able to replicate. Okay, it should be able to replicate so that it will segregate in the daughter cells also. Okay, so it is the important thing, and therefore ORI region should be present on the vector. Okay, so that the replication could start easily. Then the second point is vector should contain a selectable marker for identification and isolation. For example, if I take this vector. Okay, selectable marker, for example, these selectable markers are used for the identification and isolation of the host cells carrying the plasmid. Okay, for example, I will make it clear. Okay, for example, you have you can see here, these are the recombinant DNA which you want to express in the host cell. Okay, so you have simply carried out the protocol, and now the host cell are carrying this recombinant DNA. Okay, this is the E. coli acting as a host cell, and among these three host cell, only two of the E. coli cells are having or they are carrying the recombinant DNA, right? So how you are going to identify whether our recombinant DNA is inserted in the host cell or not? Okay, how will you differentiate these two cells with this one cell? Okay, for this purpose, the vector carries selectable markers. Okay, for this purpose, the vectors carry selectable marker. Okay, for example, selectable marker we are taking here as the antibiotic resistance gene. Okay, for example, the vector will contain a region which is resistant to antibiotic. Okay, for example, it is resistant to tetracycline. Tetracycline is an antibiotic. Okay, and this tetracycline resistance gene is present in the recombinant DNA. Okay, for example, here this tetracycline resistance gene is present. Okay, so if I place these cells in a plate, in a nutrient agar media containing tetracycline, then what will happen? Then what will happen? Only those cells are going to survive which are possessing the recombinant DNA, right? These are the cells which are having the recombinant DNA. And those cells, the remaining cells are going to easily lyse out. The lysis is carried out because these cells are lacking the recombinant DNA, and due to lack of recombinant DNA, there is no expression of tetracycline resistant gene. Okay, this recombinant DNA was having the gene for expression of these kind of tetracycline resistant gene, which expressed and which resisted the antibiotic which was present on the plate, and therefore the cell was survived. Okay, so it is the purpose for the presence of selectable marker on the vector DNA. Okay, I hope you are clear with this second point. It is very important, and there is not necessity that only one antibiotic resistance gene can be present. Multiple antibiotic resistance gene can be present on the vector DNA. Okay, I have taken an example of tetracycline. Similarly, ampicillin resistance gene is also most of the time present on the vector. Now we will see the third point. Vector should have preferably short DNA sequence. It is very important point that the vector is smaller, the higher it is having the ability to carry the foreign DNA. Okay, it is also known as load carrying capacity. Load carrying capacity is nothing but the ability of the vector to carry the foreign DNA. Okay, the ability of this vector to carry the foreign DNA. For example, higher size of vector, higher the size will be of vector, the smaller is the load carrying capacity. Okay, for example, the vector is of size 10 kb. Okay, then its load carrying capacity means the size of the foreign DNA fragment it can carry can be around 20 kb. Okay, for example, I'm just taking the example. Okay, this is a random example. Similarly, if the size of vector is 50 kb, then the load carrying capacity will be less. For example, here it can be 6 kb load carrying capacity. In case A, the vector size, it is having a large DNA sequence which makes it comparatively weak to carry the foreign DNA. Okay, it can carry only 6 kb of the foreign DNA fragment. If your DNA target gene is a small size, you can use such kind of vector. But if you want to insert large kb of DNA fragment, you will see that you will have to use the vectors which are having short DNA sequences. okay, we are going to study several examples, and at that time you will be clear with this thing. Okay, so it was one of the most important characteristic regarding the vector. Okay, there is inverse relationship between the vector size and the load carrying capacity. Moving on next, it should have closely spaced multiple target sized for restriction endonuclease, which are also termed as polylinker. Okay, so for example, till now we have studied that this is the vector, and this vector is going to contain the ORI region, then antibiotic resistance gene. Okay, for example, these are the antibiotic resistant gene. Okay, along with that, there should be presence of restriction sites. Okay, these are the restriction sites. Restriction sites are important for opening of the vector DNA. Okay, these restriction sites are recognized by a particular enzyme, which is restriction endonuclease. And remember, it is very specific. It is very specific. Type 2 restriction endonuclease is highly specific. Okay, it is going to recognize specific sequence of the DNA, and it is going to simply carry out the cut. Okay, so the benefit of having multiple target site on the vector DNA is that you can see multiple pruning sites should be present so that any restriction enzyme can be used. Okay, for example, this is restriction in enzyme for BAM H1, then this is for HIND3, okay, and this is for ECO-R1. Okay, this is different restriction endonuclease. So here you can see that you are having multiple choices for targeting the DNA, for cleaving out the vector DNA. Okay, restriction endonuclease will carry out the cut in such a form that the vector will open up, and now you can easily insert your foreign DNA right here. Okay, this is the most important function of restriction endonuclease. Okay, so these are the four important points. You can also see that multiple sites, multiple cloning sites are also termed as polylinkers. Okay, so this is the four important points regarding vector DNA. Okay, so now finally we are going to start with the cloning vector. Okay, so the first vector that we are going to study today is plasmid. Okay, in the further video lectures, I will be going to discuss regarding bacteriophages, then cosmids, plasmids, as well as artificial chromosome. Okay, so for now we will start with the plasmids. So before talking about the plasmid, it is important to know the history from where plasmids were taken into account. Okay, so in earlier time, it was known that a particular species of bacteria, for example, if I take E. coli, in E. coli, there was reported that there is presence of genomic DNA. Okay, this is also a genomic DNA. In some strains of E. coli, it was reported that some strains were known to possess extra chromosomal material. Okay, this is the genetic material which is different from the genomic DNA, okay, which is different from the main DNA of the host cell, okay, or the E. coli. You can see here the cells which are containing this extra chromosomal segment were termed as F positive cells, and the cells which were lacking such kind of fragment were termed as F negative. Both of them are E. coli cells, but there is difference in the strains. Okay, so the one strain is having the factor which is, therefore the cell is termed as F plus, means this E. coli cell, this strain of E. coli is having this factor, and the another cell is lacking this factor, therefore it is termed as F negative. Okay, this in earlier time, this extra chromosomal material was termed as factor. Okay, I'm also mentioning here in earlier times. But after that, it was also noted that when both the cells, when both the F positive and F negative cells when kept together, it was found that the F positive cell The F-positive cell having the extra chromosomal DNA was able to express certain proteins which are involved in formation of such kind of tube. Okay, and this is termed as conjugation tube. Okay, and the expression of proteins which are involved in formation of this kind of conjugation tube is from the factor. Okay, a factor which is the extra chromosomal material expresses its DNA, and the proteins are involved in formation of this conjugation tube. From this conjugation tube, there is a rolling circle replication, the method by which this factor replicates and one of its strand gets inserted in the F negative cell. Okay, for example, I'm drawing here the genomic DNA, and this is our vector, sorry, the factor. So one of the strand will simply is going to replicate through rolling circle replication method, and it is going to get transferred in this cell. Okay, for example, it has reached in this cell. Once it has segregated properly, it is simply going to replicate. Okay, this strand is simply going to replicate because there is presence of the region termed as ORI region. And now the F negative cell has been converted to F positive cell. Okay, this is nothing but this is the conjugation method. Okay, in earlier times, this protocol was carried out, and it was reported that certain kind of genetic material or genetic elements which were termed as factor was able to replicate inside the cell, and these factors were also capable of getting transferred to another cells which were lacking such kind of factor by formation of conjugation tube, and this process is termed as conjugation. You can see here the F negative cell can be converted to F positive cell by this conjugation method. Okay, later in 1952, what happened? Joshua Lederberg was a scientist. He was working on these cells and these factors. He called such factors as plasmids. Okay, he has given the name to such factors as plasmids. So he has also given a statement or a definition for plasmids, that these are self-replicating. They can replicate independently within the host cell. Okay, they are not dependent on the genomic DNA. They can replicate independently and can create its multiple copies. Okay, for example, this is the host cell, this is the genomic DNA, and these plasmids are able to replicate independently and produce its multiple copies. Okay, these are self-replicating, and then these are extra chromosomal, these are double-stranded and circular DNA. Okay, so it has no relation with the genomic DNA. They are present independently, they can replicate independently, they are double stranded, and they are circular form of DNA. Okay, so this is the definition of plasmid. So now the question arises that is plasmid essential for the normal life cycle of a bacteria? For example, there are two plasmid, one is this bacteria and another one is this bacteria. Now the question arises, if plasmids are not present in this case, for example, then this bacteria is going to die or not? The question is, the bacteria is having no direct relationship with the plasmid. For example, this bacteria is also going to survive. Okay, this bacteria is also going to survive. It clearly indicates that plasmids are not essential for the normal survival of the bacteria. Both the bacteria are going to survive if they are plated on a nutrient media. Okay, then what is the benefit of having plasmid? With the evolution, why the plasmids are still present in such kinds of bacteria? What portion of them is contributing positive impact to the bacteria? Okay, so the thing is that due to this presence of plasmids, the bacteria has certain benefit of survival under certain conditions. Okay, for example, if I plate the same bacteria in a plate containing antibiotic, then what will happen? If I will plate this, it is simply observed that those cells having the plasmid were survived. Okay, those cells having the plasmids were survived, and those cells having, this is the colony of bacteria, colonies of bacteria having plasmid. Okay, and these cells, the colonies of these cells are simply lysed out. Okay, these are the this is the lysis of cell. So you can see here, under extreme condition, when the cells are exposed to certain extreme condition, for example, antibiotics, heavy metals, or a pollutant. So at this time, plasmid is going to put its impact and it is going to be responsible for the survival of the strain. Okay, and those cells which are lacking such kind of plasmids or extra chromosomal material, they are simply going to die. Okay, under normal condition, under favorable condition, there is no necessity of carrying plasmids. But under extreme conditions, it is important that if the cell want to survive, it should contain such kind of genetic material in the form of plasmids. Okay, now talking about the size and the amount of plasmids, plasmids cover about 0.1% to 5% of the total DNA, and it is known to carry up to 100 different genes. Okay, they carry about 100 genes. Okay, second point is the size of plasmid can vary from 1 to 500 kb. Okay, for example, a plasmid termed as PBR 345, it is around of size of 0.7 kb. okay, and if I talk about F plasmid, the size of F plasmid is 95 kb. okay, similarly its size varies with the strain of bacteria or species of bacteria. Okay, so now we have studied about the amount as well as size of plasmid. Talking about the first type of plasmid, we will study about the copy number of plasmid. So on the basis of this copy number, the plasmid can be divided into two different types, that is low copy number and high copy number. So what is copy number? Copy number is number of same plasmid molecule present in a single cell of bacteria. Okay, for example, if I take here a bacteria, this is its genomic DNA and these are plasmids. So you can see here, in this case, the number of same plasmid molecule present in a single cell of bacteria. You can see here the red plasmids. There are three red plasmids and there are two green plasmids, right? So the copy number of red plasmid is 3 and the copy number of green plasmid is 2. Okay, read it carefully, that the number of same plasmid molecules. It is possible that a bacteria can carry different plasmids, okay, because a conjugation process can be there and there can be transfer of different plasmids in different cells. Okay, on the basis of this, it is divided into two categories, low copy number and high copy number. When the copy number of such kinds of plasmids is very much less, for example, if it is between 1 to 20, then it comes under low copy number plasmid. Okay, obviously, if the bacteria is of this much size and the copy number is also very much less. If the copy number is very much less, means what? The plasmids are going to be obviously larger in size. Okay, these are going to be larger in size. Okay, so two points which I have covered in low copy number. If we turn to high copy number plasmids, you can see more than 20 copies per cells will be present. Okay, this is a high copy number cell and this is a low copy number cell. If the copy number, for example, in this case, the red, for example, there is red plasmid and the number is 25. So these are obviously going to be small in size and the copy number are more than 20. In this case, you can see the copy number lies between 1 to 20, and therefore the plasmids are obviously going to occupy the space and they are larger in size. The third important point is replication is stringent. Low copy number plasmid, they replicate only when the genomic DNA replicates. Okay, means the replication is carried out only once in their lifetime when the genomic DNA replication replicates, when there is replication of genomic DNA. Okay, in case of high copy number, the replication is relaxed, means In this case, the high copy number plasmids are not dependent on the replication of genomic DNA. They can replicate independently. Okay, similarly, the second point is also similar. In this case, the replication is synchronized with the replication of genomic DNA, and here it is not synchronized, it can replicate independently. Also, the most important point in low copy number is that they possess stabilizing as well as PAR loci. This stabilizing and PAR loci are present on the low copy number plasmid. Okay, and these genes are responsible for the segregation and assortment of plasmids in daughter cells. Means what? When the cell is going to multiply, it is important that there is proper distribution of these plasmids in the daughter cells. Okay, so for this purpose, it is in low copy number plasmids, there is such kinds of loci, that is stabilizing and PAR loci. There is a mechanism in which the distribution of plasmid is equal between cells. Okay, this is advantage in low copy number plasmid. Okay, as well as you can see here in high copy number plasmid, such kind of loci are totally absent. Means the distribution of plasmid in this case is random. Okay, now the second type of plasmid we will be talking about, the conjugative and non-conjugative plasmid. By the term itself, you should understand that just now we have studied about the conjugation method. Okay, on the basis of that, you can classify it into conjugative and non-conjugative forms. Conjugative plasmids are self-transmissible. They can transfer the, it can replicate and transfer one of its strand into the another bacterial cell by the conjugation method. Whereas non-conjugative plasmids are non-self-transmissible. Okay, in conjugative plasmids, there is going to be a presence of certain kind of transfer gene, TRA gene and MOB gene, that is mobilizing gene. These genes are going to express a protein which will help in carrying out the transferring or mobilizing moment. They are high molecular weight plasmids and they are low copy number. Okay, means obviously the molecular weight is going to be high. Okay, they are inversely related. In non-conjugative plasmid, there are absence of such kind of genes due to which they cannot be transferred easily. They are comparatively having less molecular weight and therefore the copy number is very much high. Okay, they can replicate inside the host cell, but they are not having the ability to get transferred to another bacterial cell. So this is the conjugative and non-conjugative plasmid. Okay, in this case, the molecular weight is inversely related with the copy number. You can see here. Okay, now, talking about the forms of plasmids, there are four forms of plasmids. You can see here, plasmid can exist in these different forms. Okay, and also they can be converted from one form to another. For example, the first one is covalently closed circle. Covalently closed circle. This is the first one. You can see here, these are double-stranded circular plasmid and these are the most common plasmids. Open circle plasmids, in this case, one of the two strand is open. Okay, for example, the inner strand can be open in this way or the outer strand can be open in this way. Okay, I will draw it properly. Okay, this is open circle, means any one of the strand is broken, either outer strand or inner strand. In third case, it is linear plasmid. In case of linear plasmid, you will see that both the strands of the circular DNA is broken, which causes them to linearize. Okay, this is a simple statement. Both the strands are broken so that they can be stretched to form a linear plasmid. Supercoiled plasmid, it is formed when the plasmid is quite large, okay, when the size of plasmid is quite large, so it leads to the coiling of the plasmid. For example, this is the plasmid, so it is simply going to coil down. Okay, this is the supercoiled plasmid. Okay, these are different forms of plasmids you can see here, and they can be easily interconverted from one form to another. Okay, there is also a term named as cryptic plasmids. Cryptic plasmids are known for the plasmids whose function are not known. Okay, so these are cryptic plasmids. So now you will have to find what are the examples of cryptic plasmids, and you will have to mention it in the comment box. Okay, so it is your duty to have a little work done while studying this vector. Okay, so now we will be talking about natural and artificial plasmids. Talking about natural plasmids, the plasmids which are present naturally within the bacterial cells, there is no cloning experiment carried out. Such plasmids are termed as natural plasmids. They are naturally present. Okay, for example, PMB1 is a type of natural plasmid. It is an example of natural plasmid. Talking about artificial plasmids, these kinds of plasmids are constructed in vitro in laboratory. And the construction of such kinds of plasmids are carried out by using different natural plasmids. Okay, different natural plasmids are taken, and certain fragments of DNA is taken from these natural plasmids, and a single plasmid is formed. A single plasmid is formed in this way. Okay, so this is the construction of artificial plasmid which is carried out in vitro, okay, in the laboratory. So example of artificial plasmid is PBR322, because three different plasmids, natural plasmids, were taken for the construction of this plasmid. Okay, so finally we will be talking about the PBR322 plasmid. This is the most common and popular plasmid because it is having certain advantage to carry out in laboratory condition. Okay, it is also known as the workhouse of gene cloning laboratory, okay, because it is highly used plasmid. The full form of PBR stands for, P is for plasmid, B is for Bolivar, and R is for Rodriguez. They constructed the plasmid and therefore they have named it in this way. Okay, the designation in this way. The P is small and the BR is capital, and 322 is a superscript. Okay, now this PBR322 is constructed using three different natural plasmid. The first one is PRSF2124. This plasmid is used, and the segment of DNA which is taken is ampicillin resistant gene. Means ampicillin resistant gene was isolated or cleaved out from this plasmid, this natural plasmid. Then there is PSC101. The tetracycline resistance gene was taken up from this plasmid. And the third is PMB1. The ORI region is taken from this plasmid. These three are natural plasmids and these are used for the construction of PBR322. Okay, now talking about the construction. Okay, you can see here the base pair means the size of PBR322 is 4363 base pair, or you can also simply remember it as 4.36 kilo base pairs. The molecular weight is 2.9 mega dalton. The ORI region which we have taken from PMB1 is relaxed type. Relaxed type means it is independent of for replication, means it is not dependent on for replication with the genomic DNA. Okay, it can replicate independently. It has around 40 restriction sites, 40 target sites for different restriction endonuclease. Okay, for example, you can see here, these are the restriction sites for PST1, then ECOR1, HIN3, BAM-H1, XMA3. Okay, these are the restriction sites, and around 40 different restriction sites are present. Okay. You can see here there is a gene termed as ampicillin resistance gene is present, then tetracycline resistance gene is present. Okay, then the origin of replication region is present right here. So this is the overall construction of our plasmid, which is ECOR1. Okay, now. Okay, it is having 4.36 kb size. Then the load carrying capacity means the size of foreign DNA it can handle is around 6 kb. Okay, it can carry about 6 kb of foreign DNA on it. Then the replication, as I have mentioned, it is relaxed type, and because of which you can obtain multiple copies of the plasmids or multiple copies of your target DNA. Okay, along with that it is also having two antibiotic resistance gene. Okay, for example, you cut out this segment. Okay, and for example, we are targeting this two segment, HIN3 and EcoR1. You have used two different restriction endonuclease, that is HIN3 and EcoR1. And after removal of this segment, you have inserted the foreign DNA. This foreign DNA size can be up to 6 kb. It is its load carrying capacity. Apart from that, the replication is relaxed type, means once it is going to get in the host cell, it can multiply independently. Along with that, your foreign DNA is also going to multiply. It is going to replicate, transcribe and translate. And finally, there is going to be expression of your protein in the culture system or in the genetic engineering system, whatever source you are taking up. Okay, so this was about the characteristics of PBR322. It has also noted that there is two disadvantage of PBR322. The first one is that it can easily lost in continuous culture. Okay, because this plasmid is having very much less stability in culture system. The second is it can replicate only in gram-negative bacteria, for example, in E. coli. Okay, so still it is used commonly because the disadvantage is not observed very much. Okay, so you can go with PBR322 if you want to work with foreign plasmids having such carrying capacity. Okay, having such load carrying capacity. Okay, so I hope you are clear with this PBR322 plasmid. Then there are also commonly used plasmid termed as PBR327, then PBR329, then PUC, which stands for University of California. Along with that, there are PUC18 and PUC19. Okay, and then there is PGEM3, PGEM4. Then there is also PSP64 as well as PSP65. Okay, they are also derived from PUC vector. Okay, these are derived from PUC vector. Okay, so I hope you are clear till all these points. You have understood plasmids well. In the next session, we will be covering another plasmids. Till that, you study this, make your note, and still if you are having any kind of doubt, you can simply ask me in the comment section. Okay, don't forget to like, share and subscribe, and also don't forget to follow us on our new Instagram channel, that is Learn Life Science, for regular updates on learning. Okay, thank you so much for watching.